Welcome, students. My name is Mr. Little, and today we're going to be doing an SAQ, short answer question, review for AP Social Studies classes. So whether you're in AP Euro, AP World, AP US, this review is for you. In these SAQ reviews, we're going to be using something called the ACE method to answer the SAQ. Now, if you are familiar with the ACE method, if your teacher uses it, great, awesome. If you are not familiar with the ACE method, please pause this video and go ahead and read this handy chart I've put here explaining how the ACE method works. Whether you've just heard about it or this is something you're familiar with, that's okay because we're going to ACE the SAQ. So before we get to the actual review itself, I want to quick go over the two purposes of this review. Purpose number one, to practice writing a short answer question using publicly available released College Board SAQs, all of which are going to be linked in the description below. Second thing, to review content via a broad overview. The great thing about SAQs is they tend to touch on big course themes or big course topics. And so by going through these questions, by thinking them through and brainstorming possible answers to them, it gives us an opportunity to do a little bit of content review. All right, so here we have an image-based SAQ, two image-based SAQ that is a combination of Unit 6 and Unit 9 put together. And this one has been slightly modified for the purpose of this presentation, but I happen to really like this SAQ. It's literally one of my favorites of all times, because not only do I like maps, but I like maps with data. And if you look at the source of this particular image, as you should always when you get any sort of image, you can see that the top map up here is British, Spanish, and Dutch trade routes shown by ship logs between 1750 and 1800. So pre-age of imperialism, Atlantic revolutions. And then the bottom one includes ship lanes in 2010. So that's the modern day. And the difference is just startling. We'll take a closer look at it later. But we have three questions attached to this. One, identify one limitation of using the map to measure global interactions, reason for continuities in the patterns of global economic interactions from 1750 until now. So basically, again, change continuity and a limitation. So as I said, this is literally my favorite SAQ because there's so much detail. I mean, look at this, right? So for example, in the first map, you can clearly see the triangle trade. You can see the trade coming from West Africa over to the Americas, back over to Europe. But you can also see the other end of the triangle trade, right? You can see how many European ships were going down around the Cape of Africa and into the Indian Ocean, right? Remember, that was the whole reason for the Age of Exploration, find a new way to get to India around the Portuguese, who had found this way to go around Africa. Notice in the second map that there are a lot of straight lines, and I've often thought that maybe that's because of better navigational tools. I mean, you have better navigational tools, you'll have more consistent shipping lanes and shipping routes. Also, notice in this one that the Panama Canal, which runs between North and South America, the second map, and the Suez Canal that runs between Africa and the Middle East, very clearly visible. And look how heavy the lines are that go from Europe through the Mediterranean and down out into India, right? There are still ships going around the coast of Africa, but not nearly as many as it looks like are going through the Suez Canal, as you can see from the darker hatch lines. Also, whereas in the top map, very little trade going on up here in East Asia, Japan, Korea, you could chalk that up to the fact that both the Chinese government and the Japanese government at the time were quote unquote closed off. Now, there's a lot of issues with using the term closed off, but the point is they had strictly limited trade on an official level. Didn't mean trade didn't happen, but the other thing to keep in mind here is that this first map is only showing European logs, not necessarily the logs of all the merchants doing all the business in the region, right? It's much more clear to see on the second map that in fact, East Asia, Japan, Korea, China, the Philippines, Taiwan, and Southeast Asia have huge, huge amounts of traffic. I mean, look at all that. And that could reflect like the fact that China is now an industrial powerhouse and that Japan is part of the world system. And the west coast of the North American continent is now fully developed. If you look closely at the first map, you can barely make out that the Manila galleons leave from Acapulco. It's very faint, but if you look at the west coast of the United States on the first map, you can see the Manila galleons making their way across the Pacific. There's just so much to unpack here. It's great. That's why I love this SAQ. Pause this video and take about 3 minutes and see if you can brainstorm some answers. It's always critical when you're doing a writing assessment to take at least some time to do just a little bit of brainstorming before you start writing. Remember, plan more, write less. So after doing a little bit of brainstorming, these are the possible answers to each question I have come up with. So for example, question one, which asks you to identify a limitation, that is, how do these maps potentially not help us learn more about global interactions between 1750 and now? Well, one of the things is that in the second map, they don't talk about land or air transport, which became a lot bigger after the Industrial Revolution. Also, as I mentioned before, the first map only shows European ships. It doesn't take into account Southeast Asian, East Asian, and South Asian merchants who might have been traveling around, as well as the fact that in both maps, only the volume of ships, not necessarily the value of the goods, are being shown. In terms of map B, when it asks for a big reason why there's change between 1750 and now, there's a couple possible reasons. Increasing globalization, industrialization of shipping, those giant container ships that make much more trade possible much quicker. There's the transnational and multinational nature of business in the 20th and 21st century. There's, of course, as I mentioned, the creation of the Suez and Panama canals, which make shipping much quicker and much easier and more people willing to undertake that journey. And it's also a shift away from the Eurocentric global economy, right? The rise of the Pacific Rim, the rise of Japan, the rise of Korea, the rise of China most prominently. definitely indicates that more shipping may be taking place further east of Europe than it had in the first map. Now, in terms of reasons for a continuity, well, there's a couple things. One is that shipping clearly remains very important. That's kind of a low-hanging fruit, and you might have trouble explaining that one, but shipping nonetheless remains important. Shipping to and from Europe and North America, so it's still really big. If you look at the map between North America and Europe, it's still a really heavy flow. Trade in the Indian Ocean, as well as trade from Europe to South America, still remains important. While there's some changes, especially in East Asia, a lot of those traditional trade routes still remain because industrial economies still need raw materials and people still need their coffee. And as it turns out, one of the biggest coffee producers is Brazil. All right, now you are going to attempt to write an SAQ. So pause this video, go set a timer for 15 minutes, and then come on back and you can compare what you wrote to the ACE answers that I'm going to provide. Now, I want to be really clear here that there are many different ways to answer this SAQ. And so if you didn't write the exact same thing that I wrote, that's okay. That's not a big deal. So here are my three answers to those three questions. And I've used the ACE method, and you can see the color-coded key up in the corner. So question one, about limitations. I talked about how these maps don't show the traded value of goods being traded. That is a limitation. Now, since that is an identify question, all you have to do is identify the answer and then you're done. So we're done with that one. Real quick, real short. In terms of a change on the two maps, I specifically talked about the creation of the Suez Canal and how in the Indian Ocean, you see an increase in the volume of ships going there as a result of the creation of the Suez Canal. Now, notice how these answers in particular are a little bit longer than some of the other answers in some of the other videos. That's because change of continuity you need to show over time. So you need to talk a little bit about what happened before and a little bit what happened after. So I talked about Vasco da Gama and the age of colonialism. Then I talked about the 1800s at the Suez Canal in an independent Egypt. So, and for my continuity answer, I've decided to talk about the trading goods geographically limited between Western Europe and the Americas. So specifically, I'm talking about sugar, which we all know is a major export crop during the age of colonialism. European empires can't grow it in Europe itself. It's part of the whole reason they went and colonized the Americas. In addition to the fact that even after the age of colonialism is over, the continued demand for those goods and foodstuffs such as coffee, which is again geographically limited to tropical climates, explains the continued high volume of traffic that we see in the second half between Western Europe and the Americas. And so that's my continuity that I've demonstrated here over time. Alrighty, and that is a wrap for this particular SAQ review, but I'm going to encourage you to take some time, go back perhaps, and try writing a different answer using a different one of those ideas we brainstormed as possible answers. And take the ACE method, go practice with another SAQ. Keep practicing, keep reviewing. Thanks for joining me. I'm Mr. Liddle, and I'll see you next time.